Today's reading comes from Matthew chapter 17, verses 1 through 8. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James, and John his brother, and led them up to a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make 3 tents here, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Rise and have no fear. And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. This is the word of the Lord. Please be seated.
It's great to see all of you. Again, feel free to fine-tune your mobile devices to me, and you can send me messages. I do get great recipes during the sermon. Some of you have to send that to me. As you're getting the scripture in front of you ready, it'll be overhead behind me. It is in your bulletin as well, so hopefully you get lost. Just read your Bible in front of you or around you. What we're going to be doing, we're ending the series. The reason why we're going one more week, technically Christmas ended this last week, but you know we don't have to follow liturgical calendars, and really it's because I was confused. When I was running the schedule in my mind, you always have 2 Sundays after Christmas, and so it was always scheduled to do this, so that's why we're doing it. So at Ruston Presbyterian Church, we give you one more week at Christmas. We are wrapping up the series. The next series is I'm pretty excited to be looking at. We're going to be looking at feasts in Scripture. So that's the hint I'll give you for what's coming up there. But the series has been called Glorious Appearing, and we've been focusing really on times when God has appeared and really wanting to flesh out a little bit how humans have responded to God appearing, and hope to give us some insight into how we should be acting, that he has appeared, and that also he reveals himself to us on a regular basis. But to get there, I want to make sure we recap the year particularly well. Last week was the first day of 2017, and it wasn't the surveys weren't out ready yet. So let me give you a couple slides to make sure you're with me, that you were in 2016. So this first slide, what is that? Anyone know? Yes, that was Captain, I'm not promoting any of these things, but Captain America, that was the number one grossing movie around the world in 2016. This next slide, is that? That was the number one grossing movie in America. All right, so let's go to Google. What do you think was the most Googled word around the world? Pokemon. Yes, there was a Pokemon site set up in front of our church. People were running by taking their food. But that was the most Googled word around the world for 2016. It's kind of a sad state. The number one Googled word in America is
Powerball,
which is the lottery. Kind of shows you what's going on in America. The number one most Googled person around the world was Donald Trump. The number one book, the book that sold the most copies, at least according to Amazon, was The Harry Potter and the Cursed Child. That doesn't sound like a book I want to read. But that was the most book that was sold the most copies. And then lastly, for the next slide up, we lost 2 artists this year, probably 2 of the most important artists. Lots of talk of some important people we lost. But these two top them all, in my opinion. Does anyone know who they are? Interesting fact, both of them died when they were 98. This year, both of them died within 2 days of each other in November. The gentleman on your left, his name is Ping Chang Ku. He was the inventor of General Tso's chicken. The person on your right, his name is Mitchell Delegati, and he was the man who invented the Big Mac. There was not enough attention given to the losing of these icons, in my opinion. So that's just to kind of recap what's going on around the world for us here. Now as we hone in a little bit on Scripture, let me pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time and pray now that we would be challenged by your word. Holy Spirit, we can do nothing unless you reveal yourself to our hearts. So please, we ask you would take the word, apply it to our hearts and minds, so that we would leave this place differently because of you. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray and hope. Amen. So what we're looking at is the Transfiguration, one of the seminal moments in all of the Bible where Christ reveals himself, transfigures, metamorphosis, the word, reveals who he really is. And again, in the Old Testament passage, we're seeing people encountering Christ. We see them encountering the glory of God. And in Christ himself, he's that made flesh. And we get to see just a moment when a little bit of that is pulled away. Matthew, Mark, and Luke all record this. It's an important moment in Scripture. And where we want to, you know, kind of get to is a reminder that John 1:14 is that all of this, the kind of the theme verse is, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is what he did. This is what Christ did. Advent is about celebrating and preparing for that event that happened. Christ took on flesh and came to us. And so what we're looking at now, the Transfiguration, is kind of, I think, it's kind of encapsulating everything. Because you'll see that as we go through this, almost every one of the sermons I've preached on the previous 7 weeks will come up in this message, or a reminder of all those events actually happened, I think, here in the Transfiguration. So where we want to, as we're digging in, what we need to see and remind is that what the message, the gospel of Christ is promising, is that you can know him. This is what he wants. The gospel message is that he wants us to know him personally. But not just personally in a coworker kind of way, but to know him in such a way that both changes, fulfills, satisfies, and brings you to eternity. That's why Christ came, to let you know that that's what you're supposed to have with him. So let's read now, as we walk through it. I'm going to go through verses 1 through 3. And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. So what happened here? Jesus was moving from a place called Caesarea Philippi. He was moving to what we think was probably Mount Hermon. And he was moving there. This is the what happened before. He's about to go into, if you don't know, for Christ, he spent all the first part of his ministry kind of circling around Jerusalem, but he wanted to end up in Jerusalem. And this is one of the big moments that happened before he starts to make his way towards Jerusalem. And he brings with him these three particular guys, Peter, James, and John, who are considered, we know Jesus had his 12 disciples. These particular guys were considered his closer disciples, not closer because they were special, but closer because Christ pulled them in a little bit closer for times like this. And so they weren't special because they were special. They were special because Christ decided to pull them in a little more deeply. And so that's the characters involved in here. And what we're seeing now is, again, what we talked about is it says that he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And again, the word transfigured there means it's metamorphosis. He was changed before them. And up to this point, remember, every time before Jesus, when people came in contact with God, what was happening was they would come in contact with his glory and with his holiness. And that would cause people to do things. One particular example, again, as a reminder, and we'll get that in a second, we'll start now. In Exodus chapter 33, one of my first sermons in this series, when Moses comes into contact with the presence of God, what happens to him? If you were here, his face radiates by the encounter. And what commentators love to point out is the difference between, if you're trying to understand the magnitude and difference between what's happening here in terms of who Christ is versus who we are and the thing is, the difference between the moon and the sun when it comes to light, right? The sun is giving off its own light. The moon, when we see it, is just reflecting the sun's light. Moses was just reflecting a little bit of the glory that he saw when God passed by. And what they're seeing now is the glory that's been hidden by flesh, pouring out just a little bit to the point where it hit his face and even his clothes are transformed. If you are trying to think big picture what we're really seeing, we started off on Christmas. I preached on Philippians chapter 2 about who Christ was in the heavenlies. And this is what they're seeing. My very first sermon in the series was in Revelations chapter 1, when it talked about who is giving a vision to John, and it was Christ and his glory in the heavenlies. And so we're seeing, so again, just in those three previous messages, we're seeing recapped right here. When the writers of this were trying to talk about what they've seen, this is what they're talking about. They saw a little bit of what he had on his throne coming out. They give an example once before when I talked about this. If you've ever seen the movie Undercover Boss, and it's the undercover boss, the plot is, you know, a boss goes and hangs around his people and tries to be with them without them knowing, to kind of figure out what's going on. Now, Jesus isn't doing that to figure out what's going on. He's doing it to be one of us. But what's funny is in some episodes, the makeup kind of wears or changes, and they're like, I know who it is. And what's happening here a little bit is Christ has let the human flesh step aside for a second so he can reveal who it is he's seeing. And then what appears to him is Moses and Elijah. I mean, yes, Moses and Elijah. A representation of the entire Old Testament, the law with Moses and the prophets with Elijah. What we're seeing in this conversation, and what it says we read in Luke, what they're talking about, is what he's going to accomplish on the cross. And so we see these two pillars of the faith, Moses and Elijah, talking to Christ. And what they're talking about is what he's going to be doing. See, what Moses and Elijah didn't have the full picture. They understood they needed to be near God, but had been cast out because of their sin. And everything that they were calling people to do, everything they were wanting them to do, was not just fulfilled in Christ, but everything was pointing to Christ. And we see that when they pass from this life to the next one, Christ himself was filling in the dots. And now they're appearing here. And that's what they're talking about. What an amazing conversation to have listened into. That's what they're hearing. That's what they're seeing. And we get to, again, kind of what's part of the problem we're all facing, is that we talked about how the gospel promises that God's saying, you need to be with me. I want you to be with me. But the problem that so many of us, I think, find is that, in truth, we find that the desire for God weakens over time. God becomes less relevant to us. If you're in this room that you are a slightly skeptic, or know people who are, what they would probably say is, God is completely irrelevant to my life. And what many Christians find is that a lot of us, over time, Christ, his word, his glories, his graces, all these things, become less relevant to us over time. There was a great article that came out in the Washington Post that I thought was kind of funny. Actually, a couple articles have come out recently. One was the big one that came out in England, where they love to do surveys in England. One in the survey, something we've known forever, but more people claim to be atheists than even claim to be Christians now in England. I think that's just reporting a trend that's been there forever. In America, they said that for most of the churches in America are declining, except for one group. Interesting enough, churches that believe God's word to be holy and true, and proclaim a message of salvation, are the only ones that are growing in America. Almost every other denomination in America is shrinking. And the Washington Post put an article talking about how it's not like this was a secret. Mainline denominations, other denominations, have seen this coming for decades now. And they've even talked about research and books that the denominations put out to try and stop the trend. And what they said was, okay, we can see what the problem is. We're shrinking, and they're growing. Then we're pressing to churches like us who believe the Bible to be God's word and point to a necessary for our personal faith for salvation. And they said, those churches are growing, we are shrinking. Clearly, we have to do something about it. And so they decided what they need to do something about it, which is interesting. And again, because what we're saying is part of the problem of sin that I think is being addressed here is God in general, who he is, his presence becomes less relevant to us, meaning we want it less, we think we need it less. And so their solution was, okay, here's the thing. They're growing, we're shrinking. Let's see what we need to do. Clearly, we believe different things, but that can't be the difference. What we need to do is focus on believing things really passionately, but we don't need to believe what they believe. And so they put out books and research and started these study groups and things to try and change the churches from within to start growing. But they said, what we're not going to do is change what we believe. What they said, in essence, was we're just going to believe what we believe really more. Which was, again, that they're saying is God is less relevant. So what they're saying is we need to really believe his word isn't that relevant. And so they started removing, this is what they've been doing for the last couple decades, removing core tenets of the faith, core beliefs of the faith, and say what we need to do is just focus on what makes people feel good and really believe that. And that's what, because the only reason why those other denominations are growing is because they just really believe. And they said, clearly it's not what you believe, it's just that you really believe. And the Post put out an article how churches have been, mainlines have been working on this for decades now, and all of them are shrinking still. And which is interesting because the Post, which is a more theologically liberal-leaning kind of paper, kind of said maybe they need to really start thinking about what they believe for a chance, for a change, which is interesting that the Post would be talking to them about their faith. But that's what they were saying. Their message was, it's so hard to hear God talk about his holiness and his life and following him, and so black and white terms and such harsh kind of language, and no one wants to hear that. So let's soften the language and move away from it. Basically moving from a message of, remember the beginning message was, you need this gospel, to a message of, well, you're okay, but if you want it, you can add it. And the problem is, if you tell people nothing is wrong, then why would they come to you for the medicine? If you tell them okay. We believe there's something radically wrong with us. And the only medicine, the only cure, is Christ. And so these churches are doubling down and saying, we just need to really believe now, but not change our beliefs. Maybe some of you have been doing that in your own hearts as well. As God is becoming, and this is a normal process for all of us, there'll be a constant battle for God to become less relevant to your life. And so the question is, when that does happen, as it's happening maybe now, what is your solution to that problem? To abandon or to embrace something different? Let's keep going just a little bit further now. Let's look at verses 4 and 5. I started off with talking about the top big things of the year. I would say in my own life as a pastor, I'd say the top three warning things I see and natural. Like, how does it, what does becoming less relevant look like? And I said, these are the top three things I always seem to see all the time. And amongst believers, or people who are struggling, they think things like, I just have three listed here. One, a growing desire that church is no longer that important. That gathering for worship, you don't need church. Two, that you don't need that discipleship. Gobbledygook. You don't need people talking and that talking to you and praying with you and trying to prune and to work in your heart. You don't need the discipleship stuff. And lastly, a growing desire where you just don't really think it's that important for you to be interacting with other people. Either those who don't know Christ, especially those who don't know Christ, a growing desire to not worry about them, or a growing desire to just separate yourself from other believers. These are the natural ways where God becoming less relevant kind of spills out. And so you should just search your hearts and think, is this me? It could be you at times. But this is some of the natural ways where I think when we start to not understand the gospel, and think the solution is to look to other people or other things to satisfy us, then the immediate result is for the gospel to become less relevant. Now let's go to verses 4 and 5. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make these tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." So Peter was making the same mistake. God becoming less relevant. The problem is you just don't understand how important God is, how wonderful he is. Peter, this is his crowning, this would be his crowning moment of ineptitude. Remember, we just talked about what's happened. The glory of God is being revealed to him. This amazing moment. Read again. Read that chapter from Revelation chapter 1. Read Exodus 33. Read Philippians 2, where they're just saying, this is amazing. This is who he is. So Peter is witnessing this. This solemn, beautiful moment. And it'd be like, you know, in a wedding service for you to kind of say, "Hey, how's it going up there?" Ruining the moment. And so not only is he ruining this moment, but at the same time, he's completely misunderstanding what it is he's seeing. Isaiah 66, verse 1, tells us that God's throne room is the universe. And you know what he calls earth? His footstool. Think about that for a second. We pride ourselves up in how great we think we are. The universe, all the heavens, are just his throne room. And the earth, compared to who God is just a footstool. That's it. You guys know what? I think it's called the Blarney Stone. And it's all the coronation that they have a stone they step on when they're inaugurated king or queen in England. It's literally just a stone. That's basically God saying you're just a rock, which is what we are. Talk to anyone who knows anything about astrology, astronomy. Just a rock. But that's all we are compared to him. And Peter is saying, remember, so it's not like Jesus, he's still trying to figure out who Jesus is, this poor guy who is loving people. His glory is being revealed. And Peter knows now, this, he's seeing this in all of its wonder, all of its awesomeness, and he's saying, "How about I build you a tent?" So he's ruining the moment. He's completely misunderstanding what it is he's seeing. And you know what's bad when God himself has to interrupt you and say, "Just stop talking." That's basically what happens. God comes and says, "Shh, Peter, stop talking." And he says, "Listen to him. Just listen to him." This word "listen" means both to hear and obey. Don't just hear him, but obey what he's saying. We are so guilty of hearing, but maybe not obeying. You can't obey unless you hear. You can try to obey, but if you're not hearing, you're missing it. He's saying, hear, listen to him. It's an imperative. Listen to what God, listen to what Christ is saying. The solution to you being confused, Peter, is just to listen to Jesus. Recently, as you know, I have 4 kids, and I was in charge of lunch, and one of my beautiful children was eating a sandwich and just said, "Father, may I have some milk?" He didn't say it that way, but he said, "Can I have some milk, please?" I said, "Yes." And I'm helping my kids with their sandwiches. "Dad, can I have some milk?" "Yes." Doing my stuff. "Dad, can..." "Yes, sir." "Yes." Doing it. Lunch is getting all the sandwiches out. Everyone's done. Give me your plates back. Let's clean it all up. Done. I was, you know, looked like an ace. The kitchen was clean. And everyone was getting up. And my one son was still just sitting in his chair at the high table just waiting. I'm like, "What are you doing here?" And he looked at me. I'm like, "Oh, I never gave you your milk." And I went and got to him and I was like, "I'm so sorry. I was hearing him, but I was not at all doing what he was asking." In the same way, what God is saying at this moment, when you understand who Christ is in all his glory, the best thing you can do is to listen, to hear and obey what it is Christ is saying. When God becomes less relevant to you, you become distracted in your capacity to hear and obey him. Then verse 6 and 7 come into play, and it says this, "And when the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, 'Rise and have no fear. And they were left, and when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. Again, their response was just like Joshua had in chapter 5. Again, all these sermons are all playing into what we saw here. When Peter and all of them, they finally realized what it is they're seeing, they finally had the right response, which is to fall down. And in Isaiah chapter 6, where the angel had to come and touch the lips of Isaiah so he could respond, Jesus had to come and touch them and say, you can interact with me now. And when the experience was over, Christ affirmed everything they needed to know. Rise and have no fear. That's the embodiment, that's the message that Christ needs us to hear. That in him, and through him, and by him, we have no fear. Apart from him, we have nothing but fear and condemnation. But now with him, there is no fear. So the problem to irrelevancy, of Christ becoming irrelevant to you, the problem that so many of these churches are missing is that who and what and how you believe are important, all three of them. Who you believe in is essential. Yourself, your own strength, or is in Christ. What you believe. For so many people today, I will follow Christ, but what I believe is not essential. And hear the words of God the Father saying, listen to Christ. What you believe is so important, and how you believe. What I mean by that is this. I know some people say, I believe this stuff, but I just don't have time to follow. I love him, but I just don't have time. How you love God, his word, how you love Christ is just as important. It's not any one of these things individually. It's all of them. So what happens if you have the right who and the what and the right how? What happens is, what the gospel says, is that you're brought into that presence. We have but a small taste of it now. It's spiritual now. But in the end, it'll be physical. We'll be physical and physically in this presence. So what Christ is saying is, if you trust his word, you hear his word, you obey his word, the blessing you receive, what you receive, is his presence. The glory, the holiness, the majesty, he envelops us with that. Where the heavens are his throne room and earth is but his footstool. He wants you to bring you into that presence. So lastly, we're just going to end with this. So how do you avoid this common mistakes in hardened faith? First, how do you see it happen in your own heart? You have to pray and ask God and see and ask him to reveal your own heart to you. And as he reveals your own heart to you, your only response is to repent. It is not to try harder. It is not to love more. Your only response is to repent. So your prayer needs to be, God, are you relevant to me? Show me how you're not. And where he shows you he's not, you repent. And where he shows you he is relevant to you, you rejoice. And lastly, what about others? How do you know others? If you are a skeptic or know people who are, then your command is this, ready? To enjoy God and glorify him with your life. That is the message you proclaim to others. That is, you help others find the one true God by enjoying him and proclaiming his holiness and goodness. So the whole series is about the presence of God. Is he present in your life, and how is he present? It all must point to Christ, and it all must come from Christ. That was the point of this series. I hope you guys are encouraged, and I hope that you understand how essential it is for Christ's presence to be your desire. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for how wonderful you are. Lord, you are too high for us to understand, too deep for us to fathom, too glorious for us to behold, but you come to us You come to us that we may know you. Lord, help us to desire you to be relevant in our lives. Reveal to us where you are irrelevant, and help us to see the solution is not for us to do more, but is for you to lead our hearts to you again. We thank you for your word. We thank you for this time. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.